I think I read from the passage this morning without announcing where I was reading from. So I won't make that mistake this evening. We're reading from 1 Kings chapter 6. 1 Kings chapter 6. Let us hear the word of God. Solomon is in the process of building the temple. And it came to pass in the 480th year after the children of Israel had come out of the land of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel in the Mount of Ziv, in the month of Ziv, which is the second month, that he began to build the house of the Lord. Now the house which King Solomon built for the Lord, its length was 60 cubits, its width 20, and its height 30 cubits. The vestibule in front of the sanctuary of the house was 20 cubits long across the width of the house, and the width of the vestibule extended 10 cubits from the front of the house. And he made for the house windows with beveled frames. Against the wall of the temple he built chambers all around, against the walls of the temple all around the sanctuary and the inner sanctuary. Thus he made side chambers all around it. The lowest chamber was 5 cubits wide, the middle was 6 cubits wide, and the third was 7 cubits wide. For he made narrow ledges around the outside of the temple, so that the support beams would not be fastened into the walls of the temple. And the temple, when it was built with stone, finished at the quarry, so that no hammer or chisel or any iron tool was heard in the temple while it was being built. The doorway for the middle story was on the right side of the temple. They went up by stairs to the middle story and from the middle to the third. So he built the temple and finished it, and he panelled the temple with beams and boards of cedar. And he built side chambers against the entire temple, each 5 cubits high. They were attached to the temple with cedar beams. Then the word of the Lord came to Solomon, saying, concerning this temple which you are building, if you walk in my statutes, execute my judgments, keep all my commandments and walk in them, then I will perform my word to you which I spoke to your father David. And I will dwell among the children of Israel and will not forsake my people Israel. So Solomon built the temple and finished it. And he built the inside walls of the temple with cedar boards. From the floor of the temple to the ceiling, he panelled the inside with wood, and he covered the floor of the temple with planks of cypress. Then he built the 20-cubit room at the rear of the temple, from floor to ceiling with cedar boards. He built it inside as the inner sanctuary, as the most holy place. And in front of it, the temple sanctuary was 40 cubits long. The inside of the temple was cedar, carved with ornamental buds and open flowers. All was cedar, there was no stone to be seen. And he prepared the inner sanctuary inside the temple to set the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord there. The inner sanctuary was 20 cubits long, 20 cubits wide, and 20 cubits high. He overlaid it with pure gold and overlaid the altar of cedar. So Solomon overlaid the inside of the temple with pure gold. He stretched gold chains across the front of the inner sanctuary and overlaid it with gold. The whole temple he overlaid with gold until he had finished all the temple. Also he overlaid with gold the entire altar that was by the inner sanctuary. Inside the inner sanctuary he made 2 cherubim of olive wood, each 10 cubits high. One wing of the cherub was 5 cubits and the other wing of the cherub 5 cubits. 10 cubits from the tip of one wing to the tip of the other, and the other cherub was 10 cubits. Both cherubim were of the same size and shape. The height of one cherub was 10 cubits, and so was the other cherub. Then he set the cherubim inside the inner room, and they stretched out the wings of the cherubim, so that the wing of the one touched one wall, and the wing of the other cherub touched the other wall, and their wings touched each other in the middle of the room. Also he overlaid the cherubim with gold. Then he carved all the walls of the temple all around, both the inner and outer sanctuaries, with carved figures of cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers. And the floor of the temple he overlaid with gold, both the inner and outer sanctuaries. For the entrance of the inner sanctuary he made doors of olive wood. The lintel and doorposts were 1/5 of the wall. The 2 doors were of olive wood, and he carved on them figures of cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers, and overlaid them with gold. And he spread gold on the cherubim and on the palm trees. So for the door of the sanctuary, he also made doorposts of olive wood, 1/4 by the wall. And the 2 doors were of cypress wood. 2 panels comprised one folding door, and 2 panels comprised the other folding door. Then he carved cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers on them, and overlaid them with gold applied evenly on the carved work. And he built the inner court with three rows of hewn stone and a row of cedar beams. In the fourth year, the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid in the month of Ziv. And in the 11th year, in the month of Bul, which is the 8th month, the house was finished in all its details and according to all its plans. So he was 7 years in building it. I have to admit that 1 Kings chapter 6 is not a chapter that I've ever turned to for spiritual comfort. It's all about temple building, and personally speaking, reading details about temple construction doesn't exactly get my spiritual juices flowing. No doubt others might respond differently. If you're an architect or a quantity surveyor, perhaps this passage may excite you. It's great that we're different, isn't it? Sometimes in Presbytery I listen to folk discussing the church code, and for the life of me I can't get excited about it. How one can get excited about such a dry and dreary document is beyond me, but some folk are obviously in their element discussing such matters. If I was going to read a church code, I think I would read it to help me to get to sleep, but that's about it. Having said that, I'm glad we do have one. And sometimes when we need guidance, it does actually throw light on the proper way to do things. And at that point, I realise that it does have some value after all. Now, when I began to study this passage, rightly or wrongly, it didn't inspire me the way other passages of Scripture do. But then I brought to mind the fact that this passage is as much part of God's Word as John 3. Furthermore, these things were written for our learning, that we through the comfort and the patience of the Scriptures might have hope. Considered in isolation from other passages of Scripture, you could easily end up wondering, what is this all about? But when you study it in context and compare it and contrast with what has gone before and what follows, it all opens up and it begins to make sense. The key to profiting from a passage such as this is to interpret it in the light of the whole Bible. When Moses made the tabernacle, he made it according to the pattern God gave on the mount. God said this is the way it's to be done, and that was the way Moses did it. And Solomon did exactly the same when building the temple. God gave him precise instructions as to what he was to do. 1 Chronicles 28, verse 11, God gave his son Solomon the plans for the vestibule. David gave his son Solomon the plans for the vestibule, its houses, its treasuries, its upper chambers, its inner chambers, and the place of the mercy seat. Verse 12, and the plans for all that he had had by the Spirit of the courts of the house of the Lord, of all the chambers all around, of the treasuries of the house of God, and of the treasuries for the dedicated things. Verse 19 again says, all this, said David, the Lord made me understand in writing by his hand upon me all the works of these plans. So all these instructions were given by God. That was the case with regard to the tabernacle, and it was also the case with regard to this temple. And Hebrews 9 verse 23 says that these things are copies of things in heavens. In the heavens. In other words, they are part of God's progressive revelation, whereby little by little and precept upon precept, he reveals to us the wonder of a salvation that is found in Christ. So it would be a big mistake to look at this passage as providing us with lessons in ancient architecture. That's not the purpose of this. Rather, we must understand it in the light of the timeless truths that are foreshadowed here, truths which build upon previous revelation and prepare us for future revelation. As Arthur Pink apparently said in his deathbed, Scripture interprets Scripture. So we're going to look at the temple in the light of the whole Bible tonight. And the first point I want to make is this: the historical situation enlightens our minds. The historical situation enlightens our minds. You're probably aware that if the Jews had their way, they would build another temple precisely like this one, or perhaps even greater, on the very spot where it was once situated. Over the centuries, there have been three temples. Solomon's temple, the one we read about here, Haggai's temple, the one that was built after they returned from captivity, and Herod's temple, which was razed to the ground in AD 70 by the army of Titus. And since that time, the Dome of the Rock, an Islamic holy site, has been erected in its place. And to this day, there's a lot of dispute and controversy concerning the same plot of land. It would be no exaggeration to say that if someone attempted to bring about a change here and rebuild the temple, it could probably lead to a Third World War. So even today, this whole matter is controversial. But I want for a few moments to emphasize the place of the temple in the history of redemption. So here's a bird's eye summary of what the temple means in the history of redemption. In an earlier day, God had dwelt among his people at the tabernacle, according to the pattern revealed to Moses in the Mount. That was where he dwelt in Shekinah glory. And it was a wonderful condescension on the part of God to do just that, to come and live among sinful people. And the imagery is beautiful if you think about it. The Israelites dwelt in tents, and God did exactly the same thing. He came and dwelt in a tent. And that foreshadows Christ, the one of whom Scripture says the Word became flesh and tabernacled literally among us. But that dwelling place was temporary, and therefore it was less than perfect. It was suitable for a people who wandered about in the wilderness. But now that they'd entered the Promised Land, something more permanent was needed. And Miriam actually hinted at this change that was to take place in her song of Exodus, a song of thanksgiving after the Exodus. She hinted that this wasn't the end of God's dealings with this world. In Exodus 15:17, she said, "You will bring them in and plant them in the mountain of your inheritance, and the place, O Lord, which you have made for your own dwelling, the sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established." And that's what was happening here. God was now coming to dwell with his people in the land in a more permanent form at the temple. And as we trace this revelation of God down the centuries, 2 Chronicles 3 verse 1 tells us how David purchased a piece of land upon which to build this temple. And there are two connections made in this particular verse of Scripture, 2 Chronicles 3 verse 1. Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem on Mount Moriah, where the Lord appeared to his father David at the place that David had prepared on the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite. Notice the two things mentioned here. The first is that the temple was situated on the same piece of land as Abraham offered Isaac in a type on Mount Moriah. So we're talking about a place that has strong associations with sacrifice. And it was also there that God provided a ram from a nearby thicket as a substitute for Isaac. The second connection here is with Arawana's threshing floor. And once again, we associate that with the sacrifice David offered to avert the wrath of God after he foolishly numbered the people. Remember how in a past day we studied that incident. Fire fell from heaven to signify that his offering was acceptable. So the temple was built on a place that has strong connotations with very vital, important biblical principles such as substitution and sacrifice. But all this was multiplied exponentially in future days after the temple was built. Because over the next 1,000 years, in this very place, similar transactions would take there on a daily basis. Multitudes of sacrifices. And had you been able to visit the temple during that period, you would have never forgotten your visit there for as long as you lived. Because the first thing that would have impacted you would have been the smell. This holy place was in reality, among other things, a sort of spiritual abattoir where thousands of animals were offered daily at God's command. And the message is always the same. There's only one way to approach this God, not without blood. And what does all this mean? Well, all of this was fulfilled in Christ. Christ fulfilled this type in two ways. First of all, he is the dwelling place of God par excellence, because in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead and bodily form. And then secondly, as Hebrews 13:10 puts it, we have an altar. And what altar do we have? The focus there is on Jesus Christ, whom God made to be sin, who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. In other words, the central message of the temple throughout the Bible is what? Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures. That is the historical situation. And I hope it enlightens us a little and helps us to understand the big picture of what this temple was all about. That's the first point. The historical situation enlightens our minds. Secondly, the chronological precision corrects our perspectives. Sometimes Scripture is not very precise in informing us when certain things happened, whereas in other cases it is remarkably precise. Now here are four situations where Scripture is so precise with regard to dates that you could have actually marked the time on your calendar. First example of that is Exodus 12, verse 41. We're told it came to pass at the end of 430 years, on that very same day, it came to pass that all the armies of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. God had already promised Abraham way back in Genesis 15 that he would bring his people into the land. And Exodus 12 promises that tells us that this promise was fulfilled 430 years later. And God made a precise note of the date. Something unusual was happening here. And then we're told that 480 years after that, the period of wandering came to an end in Solomon's time, when the people of God entered a more stable period of rest. You see, we're talking about different stages in the history of redemption here. And this is the period we're presently considering. And then coming down the centuries, we're told about the return of Ezra. And Ezra chapter 1. And again, the date is spelled out, very specific. Now, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so he made a proclamation throughout his kingdom and also put it in writing. The date is noted. Further changes were taking place, you see, as the time of fulfillment grew closer. Here are situations where God was very precise in declaring the date of certain events. And then we come down the centuries yet further. And what are we told about the incarnation? When the fullness of time has come, just at the precise moment God intended, God sent forth a son made of a woman, made under the law to redeem those who were under the law. And there are three very obvious lessons we can learn from this particular focus on dates. And my point is this: the chronological precision corrects our perspectives. Because you see, God has his timetable, and it's very different from ours. These things happened when God determined. He is the God of time. Now, it's never easy waiting for God to answer our prayers. But friends, all our huffing and puffing doesn't change anything. That's because it's our duty to be patient and to wait on the Lord, because he works out all things after the counsel of his own will. And he has his time, and his time is perfect. Wait on the Lord, we're told. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. So God is his timetable. That's the first lesson we can learn here. Secondly, God is never in a hurry, but he does all things well. We're talking here about the passing of hundreds of years. But looking back, God's timing was perfect, wasn't it? Dale Ralph Davis said, we prefer a microwave God. You know what he means by that? You put something into the microwave and it's done in a moment. We want everything now. God doesn't work like that. He is never in a hurry, but he does all things well. Then the third lesson we can learn with regard to this timing. It's good to think about the place we occupy in God's timetable. And I'm really saying two things. I'm really saying, first of all, we mustn't take ourselves either too lightly or too seriously. We mustn't take ourselves too lightly, because we do have a part in God's plan. And we must discover what that part is for ourselves. But alongside that, we must never take ourselves too seriously either and think that the cause of God begins and ends with us, because it doesn't. We're only a little brick in a grand edifice of God which is beyond our imaginations. And at the end of the day, Christ will build our church, both through our efforts and even in spite of our efforts. So here is the chronological precision of God. God has his timetable, which is different from ours. God is never in a hurry. But we too have a place which we occupy. in God's timetable, although it's worth remembering as well that the next item in God's timetable, major item as far as we're concerned, is either death or the second coming of Christ. So the historical situation here enlightens our minds. Once we fit this in context, hopefully we'll understand what this is all about a little bit better. Secondly, the chronological precision corrects our perspectives. There's a specific note of timing here. In God's time, God's thoughts and God's ways are very different from our time and our ways and our thoughts. And then thirdly, I want you to notice that the unusual preparation proclaims the gospel. This temple was proclaimed in a very unusual way. We're told in verse 7 that the temple, when it was being built, was built with stone finished at the quarry, so that no hammer or chisel or any iron tool was heard in the temple while it was being rebuilt. The unusual preparation proclaims the gospel. How come, you say? Now, I worked on a building site for a time after I left university, and it was a rather noisy place to work, to say the least, because there was a constant sound of jackhammers, of dumpers and forklift trucks, men shouting and cement mixers and whatever. But this one here that Solomon supervised was very different, because there wasn't a sound to be heard anywhere. Not a sound of a hammer, nothing. All the stones had been prepared in advance by shaping them and hewing them in another place, so that when they arrived at the site, all that had to be done was for them to be gently positioned in place. And when you consider the magnitude of the stones that were used to build the temple, this was really quite something. Apparently the individual stones, and we've seen some of them when you visit Israel, some of the stones from this temple, they're 30 feet long, 7 feet high, and 3.5 feet wide, and they're 100 tons in weight. And remember, they were all moved not by JCB diggers or some fancy machinery, they were moved by manual labour. 3,300 foremen, 30,000 Israelites, and some 150,000 labourers did the work for him. Now, what does all this mean? The fact that this temple was built in such a way that there wasn't to be a sound heard anywhere. What's Scripture saying? Well, I say to you, this unusual preparation proclaims the gospel, and here's how. Comparing Scripture with Scripture, there are several gospel truths hinted at in this imagery. Firstly, we are reminded of what God himself is like and how we should approach him. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. Our mouths are shut when we face the great God, aren't they? Secondly, this scene also brings to mind the ministry of Christ, because Scripture says of him, he shall not strive nor cry, nor shall anyone hear his voice in the streets. But these arrangements here particularly remind us of God's dealings with us in grace. Friends, God is the architect of a spiritual house, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. His people are described as God's building, a habitation of God by the Spirit. Christians are the living stones who make up this spiritual structure, all resting on the one foundation stone who is Christ. His servants are the wise master builders who preach the gospel, which we have to believe if we're to become part of this structure. And what way does this building project develop? Well, the activity is largely silent. God doesn't make a big fuss when he brings something to faith, because the kingdom of God comes not with observation. God erects this building in a way that is silent, internal, and unseen. And what does he do? He takes us out of the quarry of sin, so to speak, and he shapes us and hews us by the Spirit through the Word, with the result that we become a building fitly framed together. And it's all very silent. God usually speaks not in the wind nor in the earthquake, but in the still small voice. One commentator put it like this: the finishing at the quarry suggests that none are to be laid in the spiritual building of the church, but such as are first hewed and squared by the Spirit, grace, and the Word of God. The silence of the site suggests that those who have been placed in the church should do all they can for the edification of the church in a quiet and peaceable manner, without clamour, contention, jars, and tumults. And friends, the only thing that matters is that we are part of the spiritual building. And I've said enough already to show you how it can come about. It comes about when we rest on the chief cornerstone, who is Christ, for salvation. And may God help us by his grace to promote the erection of this edifice, both as individuals and in our local church, because ultimately this is the only building that will endure. There will come a time when everything else will be brought to nothing. The unusual preparation proclaims the gospel. Fourthly, the impressive construction reflects our God. It's hard for us to imagine exactly what the temple would have looked like, but we are given sufficient information in the passage to prove that it must have been a very impressive building indeed. Now, what I'm about to say is a quantity surveyor's dream, because I'm going to give you a list of facts. But since Scripture mentions these matters, well, I'll do my best to summarize them, and hopefully it will give us some idea of the impressive construction here. And remember, it was the dwelling place of God. This reflects God. It shows the beauty of the Lord. What was this place like? Well, other scriptures indicate that the temple was situated in a garden-type setting. The language of Psalm 52, verse 8 suggests that. I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. Furthermore, the first sight that would have caught your eye as you approached it would have been the two massive pillars, Jachin and Boaz, which supported the porch. Now, we'll come across these in a future day, so I'll say something then. But that's what the first thing that would have hit your eye. Verse 3 describes the porch, which in modern day measurements would have been 30 feet long and 15 feet deep. The vestibule in front of the sanctuary was 20 cubits long across the width of the house, and the width of the vestibule extended 10 cubits from the front of the house. We're also told that there would have been several chambers here, or rooms, surrounding the temple, which would have been used for either storing vessels or as changing rooms for the priests. They're mentioned in verses 5 to 6. Against the wall of the temple, he built chambers all around, against the walls of the temple, all around the sanctuary and the inner sanctuary. Thus he made side chambers all around it. The lowest chamber was 5 cubits wide, the middle was 6 cubits wide, and the third was 7 cubits wide, for he made narrow ledges around the outside of the temple, so that the support beams would not be fastened into the walls of the temple. And then we're told that the porch itself led to the inner court where the priests ministered. Verse 36, he built the inner court with 3 rows of hewn stones and cedar beams. And that's where the altar of burnt offering would have been situated, reminding us again that God could only be approached by way of sacrifice. Around this same place, there was also a sea of brass, which we read about in other places. This was basically a very large basin standing upon 12 oxen, and it was used for various washings and ablutions. And they emphasized the need of cleansing. We need to be cleansed as we approach this God. There were also various doors leading to and within the temple itself, and they were carved with intricate figures of trees, flowers, and cherubims. Verse 32, the two doors were of olive wood, and he carved on them figures of cherubim, palm trees, flowers, and overlaid them with gold, and he spread gold on the cherubim and on the palm trees. This is the setting. Now, as for the temple itself, it was divided into two sections, the holy place and the inner shrine. The holy place was 90 feet by 30 feet by 45. We're told that in verse 2. The house which King Solomon built for the Lord, its length was 60 cubits, its width was 20, and its height 30 cubits. And no stone was evident anywhere within the temple, even though it was built with stone. Everything was covered with wooden panels. Verse 9, he built the temple and finished it, and he paneled the temple with beams and boards of silver, of cedar rather. But that's not all. Because the salient feature that would have caught your eye in this temple was the amount of gold. It was present everywhere. Look at verse 30. The floor of the temple he overlaid with gold, both the inner and the outer sanctuaries. Gold everywhere. Now, in this holy place, not the inner shrine, but in the holy place, there would have been other items of furniture here. Again, we're told about them elsewhere, that the 10 candlesticks with 7 branches and the tables of showbread, which were also covered with gold. And this holy place, which was covered in gold, was separated from the Holy of Holies by a veil of various colours, and it was built in the shape of a perfect cube. Verse 20. The inner sanctuary was 20 cubits long, 20 cubits wide, and 20 cubits high. Incidentally, it was exactly twice the size of the Holy of Holies within the tabernacle. And once again, gold abounded. The floor of the temple he overlaid with gold, both the inner and outer sanctuaries. And this inner sanctuary would have been shrouded in darkness. And the only item of furniture present there was the Ark of the Covenant with the cherubim at either end. And they too were covered in gold. Verse 28, he overlaid the cherubim with gold. And this is where God dwelt in Shekinah glory. And no one could enter this place save the high priest, and that but once a year. Apparently, when Pompey profaned the temple in AD 70, he was astonished to find that there was nothing there in the holy place, apart from the ark. You see, God is a spirit. You can't see a spirit, and no manner of similitude was permitted because it would only misrepresent the divine being. And this building was the focal point of Israel's religion. The impressive construction reflects our God. One writer has summarized the significance of this temple in three phrases. He says, firstly, the temple says glory because God is the God of glory. God is the God of glory. And indirectly, this reminds us that as individuals and as a church, we are also the temples of God, and we're to declare God's glory. So the temple says glory. The second thing the temple says is holy, because it was there that Isaiah saw the Lord high and lifted up, holy, 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 as the Lord God of hosts. And then thirdly, the temple says Christ, because he is the dwelling place of God as well as the place of sacrifice. So as we look at this temple construction, the historical situation enlightens our minds. I've tried to set this within the history of redemption. The chronological precision corrects our perspectives. Notice we're told exactly when the temple began and when it finished. This was God's doing. The unusual preparation proclaims the gospel. Everything was done in silence. The impressive construction reflects our God. And then lastly, the divine intrusion underlines our priorities. Something very strange happened here as this temple was being built. God interrupted the building of it with a message for Solomon, right in the middle of the building project. Look at verses 11 to 13. Then the word of the Lord came to Solomon, saying, concerning this temple which you are building, if you walk in my statutes, execute my judgments, keep all my commandments and walk in them, then I will perform my word with you, which I spoke to your father David. And I will dwell among the children of Israel and will not forsake my people Israel. Try and imagine what was happening here. The temple was being built, but all of a sudden, God intruded in the middle of it with this message. Now, thankfully, I've never heard a fire alarm go off in earnest. But if I did, I would heed that interruption straight away. But God himself intervened here because he wanted Solomon to know that there was something even more important than building the temple, and that was living for the God of the temple. Now, tragically, in Jeremiah's day, people had forgotten this. You remember they had a catchphrase, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. They thought if the temple was present, that guaranteed their safety, regardless of their spiritual condition. But that was a big mistake. And God warned Solomon here not to let that happen. In the middle of this project, he intervened and he said, this is what you must do. This is how you live. I'm more concerned about your heart, he said, than even what you do with your hands. We must never divorce the sacrament from God himself. And God now warned Solomon about the danger of that happening. Now, this didn't mean that Solomon was to stop building the temple, not at all. That was a good work. It had to continue, and the temple had to be built. However, while he was doing that, in fact, for the rest of the days that he lived on earth, Solomon had to keep this in mind, that God was more concerned with obedience than anything else. Basically, that was the one demand God made of him here. Obedience, if you walk in my statutes, execute my judgments, keep all my commandments and walk in them. And he said if he did that, there would be three blessings attached. The first blessing was that if Solomon obeyed God, the promises God made to him would come to pass. Verse 12b, he said, if you keep my statutes and my commandments, then I will perform my word to you, which I spoke to your father David. Then the second blessing that would follow obedience is this. God promised to presence himself among his people. Verse 13a, he says, and I will dwell among the children of Israel. Thirdly, he said that he would never forsake them. I will not forsake my people Israel. Here's three blessings we want, isn't it? We want to see God's promises fulfilled in our lives. We want to enjoy his presence. And we want him never to leave us nor forsake us. Obedience brings these blessings. But sadly, Solomon didn't enjoy them to the full, did he? Because he sinned, as we know, and he forfeited the blessings. So therefore, we need to rely on a greater king than Solomon, don't we? One who was perfectly obedient in all his ways, and one in whom all the promises of God are yea and amen. And how do we enjoy these promises? As we look to Christ and seek to follow him, then we will enjoy these blessings that God would fulfill his promises to us, that he will bless us with his presence, and that he will never leave us nor forsake us. That's something we want more than anything, isn't it? And it all comes about as we look to Christ, the one of whom the temple spoke. I'll finish with a little quotation from Ralph Dale Davis, which summarizes the passage. He says, the living God is not ashamed to speak to us about cubits and cherubim, about storerooms and cedar. But he does it in such a way that we understand his redemption, see his splendor, and feel our responsibility. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore. Amen.